Thank you very much, Chief Justice. I will proceed to summarize my judgment on some issues. I will be brief. Others, I will interrogate them a little bit more. Issue number one, is the basic structure doctrine applicable in Kenya? In order to determine whether the basic structure doctrine is applicable in Kenya, there is need to define the term doctrine under international law and establish whether the basic structure doctrine is indeed such a doctrine and if it is applicable here. I recognize that there are differing opinions on the definition of a legal doctrine, but to my mind, the basic structure doctrine as presented by the parties to us is a judge-made law emanating from the municipal court, which is the Supreme Court in India, in the Kesavananda case. That basic structure doctrine has been upheld and relied on in subsequent decisions in India, and I note that there are few jurisdictions around the world where basic structure doctrine has been applied, while in others it has been rejected. It is my considered view that the basic structure doctrine as presented by the parties does not constitute a widely adhered to legal doctrine. It is my observation that the basic structure doctrine has been both applied and rejected. I have listed the countries in which that has happened, and therefore it is my considered opinion that the states only constitute a very small percentage of countries in the world that have attempted to apply or have applied the doctrine. Furthermore, there have been no pronouncements made at the international level, no international case law on the same. The only available cases are from domestic courts at national jurisdiction, and therefore it cannot be said that the basic structure doctrine has attained the status of a general principle under international law, and it cannot be applied by this court as a general rule of international law as contemplated in Article 2, 5, of the Constitution of Kenya 10. The above notwithstanding, is the basic structure doctrine as presented by the parties applicable in Kenya? It is my considered opinion the answer to this question can only be deduced by our constitutional past. Kenyans stressed the fact that they needed a constitution that had entrenched provisions on certain aspects, was not too simple to amend, and one that required their participation in terms of amendment. The final report of the Constitution of Kenya Review Commission captures these sentiments where the people's voice is summarized. And these sentiments made it into our current Constitution, where Chapter 16 of the Constitution is unequivocal on how to amend the Constitution. It is therefore my position that it was the intention of the drafters of the Constitution to protect or entrench the specified 10 matters in Article 255(1) by stipulating their specific amendment procedures. If the drafters of the Constitution intended to entrench or protect any other provisions or deem them eternal or unamendable, they would have expressly done so. On my part, I do not consider any article in the Constitution unamendable or constituting eternity clauses. A textual reading of the Constitution confirms this view. It is evident, therefore, that the Constitution itself expressly provides an inbuilt amendment procedure for any anticipated amendments. Consequently, it is unnecessary to import the so-called basic structure doctrine into Kenya. I briefly turn to the issue of constituent power. And I find that the constituent power is a power that cannot be limited by any pre-existing rules, even if such rules purport to regulate replacement of the current constitution. It is also my finding that the four sequential steps are not expressly provided for and cannot be inferred from Article 257 of the Constitution. As such, those steps cannot be a mandatory requirement when there is no law providing for the same. Moving on to the next issue, as to whether the President can initiate changes or amendments to the Constitution. The Court of Appeal upheld the High Court's finding that the President, for as long as he held office, could not, as an ordinary citizen, move constitutional amendments through a popular initiative on the ground that the same route is intended for ordinary citizens. The appellate judges found that the amendment bill was not a popular initiative, considering that the process that culminated in the same was a process that was led and driven by the executive, the political elite, as opposed to the people of Kenya. Some respondents have urged that the proposals by the BBI task force could have been taken up by anyone else, by any promoter, but not the president himself. Having perused carefully through the judgments of the superior courts and also through the Constitution of Kenya, I find this proposition is untenable for several reasons which I shall expound upon. However, before I expound on my views, I must state I'm rather disturbed and concerned by the way the superior courts framed their issues for determination. The High Court framed its issue 3 for determination and used words not in the constitutional text, attached meaning to them, and made determination on them. At paragraph 388 of its judgment, the High Court framed the issue as follows. What is the constitutional remit of amendment of the Constitution through a popular initiative? This issue further twins into two sub-issues. Who can initiate a popular initiative under our constitutional setup? And two, is the BBI process of initiating amendments to the Constitution in conformity with the legal and constitutional requirements? And five, was the President in contravention of Article 73(1) of the Constitution for claiming authority and purporting to initiate constitutional changes through BBI? Similarly, at the Court of Appeal, Musinga, President of the Court of Appeal, listed the following issue for determination. Whether the President of Kenya can initiate the process of amendment of the Constitution as a popular initiative, and who the initiators and the promoters of BBI initiative were. The learned judges of appeal unanimously agreed with the High Court that the BBI amendment process under Article 257 of the Constitution was intended for ordinary citizens. Further, they stated that this is a citizen-conceived, citizen-initiated, and citizen-driven process. A lot of time and attention was dedicated to the meaning of certain words. This would not be problematic if these words were found within the body of the Constitution to interpret an appropriate meaning to them. However, interpretation of words not in the Constitution bring confusion. In my view, a constitutional court must confine itself to interpretation of the letter of the Constitution, and if any word or phrase is read in, it must be clear that this is the rule of interpretation at play. The words I'm concerned about include initiate and initiator, citizen initiated, and private citizen. None of these words appear in Articles 255 to 257 of the Constitution. The High Court in particular went on a spirited approach to expand on these terms and paid little attention to the words that actually appear in Chapter 16 of the Constitution, which are the words promoter, popular, and initiative. In my opinion, the learned judges introduced a non-constitutional actor called an initiator who performs a non-constitutional action, initiate, when the Constitution only provides for a promoter whose definition is vastly different from an initiator. As such, the emphasis was laid on the actor initiator. This, in my opinion, fundamentally changed the import and meaning of Article 257 of the Constitution, and I am of the opinion that the correct approach should have been to define what a popular initiative is and who can be or who is a promoter of a popular initiative. The Superior Courts ignored the fact that the drafters of the Constitution used certain words and went in to read in words whose effect is to change the entire meaning of the constitutional text. The tool of reading in is only applied where the framers have left out a word or phrase from a provision. Further, this reading in must be supported by other connected provisions of the Constitution. I perused carefully all the judgments, looking for proper reasons for the decision to exclude the president from the amendment process, and I cannot find a logical, constitutionally based explanation for the conclusions and findings of the superior courts on this question. I can only term it as interpretational misadventure, if not judicial constitutional overreach or judicial invention. As such, the learned judges erred fundamentally on this, and in my considered view, which I shall now expound on, I will specifically look at the constitutional amendment process as provided for in Chapter 16, the interpretation of constitutional silences, the exercise of the authority of the people under Article 1, the authority of the President under Article 131 and 132 and 141(3), and the political rights under Article 38. The Constitution 2010 provides for two processes through which it can be amended. These are the parliamentary initiative and the popular initiative. For the popular initiative, promoters, after collecting the signatures of at least 1 million voters, submit the signatures and the bill to IBC, who sends the bill to the counties. The bill must then be approved by a majority of the county assemblies, and then approved by a majority of the Houses of Parliament. And if Parliament passes the bill, it is submitted to the President for assent. It then goes to referendum, where the majority of voters must support it. Article 257 does not define popular initiative. Nevertheless, I am of the opinion that at the heart of construing the meaning of popular initiative, it lies with the numbers. It is proper to lay emphasis on the numerical value of at least 1 million registered voters who have to sign, the numerical value of at least half of the counties who have to vote to support, the numerical value of two-thirds of the votes in both houses in Parliament, and the numerical value of half the votes cast by registered voters at the referendum. It is the numbers that count. It is the numbers threshold that the promoter must meet. It is the numbers that makes the initiative popular. In the context of Article 257 of the Constitution, a promoter needs at least 1 million registered voters to support their proposals. That's what triggers the IEBC verification process. It is therefore my considered view that the popular initiative is primarily about numbers that the promoter must attain and not about who the promoter is or who the person who brings the amendment is. As such, the Superior Courts made a fundamental error by determining that popular, the word popular, relates to who moves the amendment and not the numerical threshold that the promoter has to attain. So, for example, in 2016, the Quad or Quad Kenya Bill were not able to achieve the 1 million signatures, and it collapsed through the operation of the law. It is important to note also that Section 257 does not in any way specify who may move a constitutional amendment process by popular initiative. It does not contain an explicit bar against any person from promoting a constitutional amendment by popular initiative. It specifically provides what actions the promoters are tasked with in order to begin and complete an amendment process, but it does not state who the promoters must be. The unsaid is influential in constitutional law. Some matters of constitutional relevance sometimes are left unaddressed. Sometimes, knowingly or unknowingly, the drafters of the Constitution may underappreciate how much power rests in the silence around the text. Constitutional silences are functional and inevitable, and enabled by a lack of very strict textual restraints, constitutions have the capacity to grow with time, experience, societal needs and changes, thus allowing successful constitutions to thrive. This Supreme Court has played a crucial role in interpreting silences in the Constitution, but it must be cautious, though, so as to avoid judicial legislation. This court must interpret silences judiciously. Taking recourse to this doctrine, therefore, how do we interpret the silence as to who can originate a popular initiative amendment? In my considered view, the first step leads us directly to the constitutional text itself. Article 1 of the Constitution is categorical, that all sovereign power belongs to the people of Kenya and shall be exercised in accordance with the Constitution. Further, in that article, sovereign power may be exercised either directly or through their democratic elected representatives. The National Executive enjoys delegated sovereign power under Clause 3 of Article 1 of the Constitution, and according to Article 36(1) of the Constitution, the President shall be elected by registered voters in a national election conducted in accordance with the Constitution. In addition, Article 1 of the Constitution elaborates the tenets of a functioning republic, anchored in the concept of libertas populi, which defines the characteristics of a functioning republic. It envisions a system that has responsible citizens who exercise their rights democratically and consciously. A free res publica is the highest value of all for citizens. Article 1 preserves the exercise of the actual legal authority or power, which is exercised by the people directly or through their democratically elected representatives. From the foregoing, there is no doubt that the president is a democratically elected representative of the people who, under Article 1, can exercise delegated sovereign power of the people. Indeed, this is one of the ways in which constituent power is exercised under our constitution, and therefore, I am confounded by the fact that the superior courts address the constituent power of the people at length, but for whatever reason failed to take into account that the president is a directly elected representative of the people and he can exercise delegated power on their behalf. Furthermore, it is a fundamental right of the Kenyan people to elect their representatives and that those so elected to speak on their behalf. To limit the ability of an elected representative to speak, to act, to work on behalf of his or her electorate is itself a limitation of the people's political rights under Article 38 of the Constitution. Such proposition would amount to limited republicanism, limiting the extent to which people exercise their powers either directly or through their elected representatives. More poignantly, however, limiting the powers of the people donated to the elected representatives reorganizes the architecture of the Constitution's order of delegated governance. It is not in dispute that the president bears an elevated status by virtue of his office. The president has additional roles and obligations in comparison to the ordinary Kenyan. In addition, Article 132 of the Constitution mandates the president to safeguard the sovereignty of the public, promote and enhance unity of the nation, promote and respect the diversity of the people and communities of Kenya, and ensure the protection of human rights and fundamental freedoms and the rule of law. Article 132 2.1c of the Constitution stipulates one of the many mandatory functions of the President. The President must once every year report in an address to the nation on all measures taken and progress achieved in the realization of the national values referred to in Article 10. In my considered view, the President is not limited as to those measures he can take to undertake he's not limited as to the measures he can undertake in the exercise of his functions under Article 132. The said measures could constitute a policy, statutory, or constitutional frame. Clearly, in promoting and enhancing national unity, the President can promote constitutional amendments through popular initiative. This would qualify as a measure taken under Article 132 on which progress achieved can be reported. It is directly within the four corners of the Constitution of Kenya. I am convinced that the President when the President takes measures in the exercise of his functions, including a proposal for the amendment of the Constitution, he is bound by the oath prescribed by the Constitution and which he swears when he takes office to act in the best interests of Kenyans and not to undermine democracy. One need not worry about the President overstepping because the parameters in the Constitution are sufficient to rein him in. How can I claim this so boldly? This is informed by our constitutional history. When one looks at the history of constitutional making in this country, it is clear that one of the intentions of the drafters of the Constitution was to discard parliamentary monopoly over the constitutional amendment process and to make it more inclusive. Kenya's journey to democratic constitution was arduous, taking into account that most of the amendments made in the first President Kenyatta's era. In the first President Kenyatta's 15-year reign, he oversaw 16 amendments. President Moi, in his 24-year presidency, oversaw 14 constitutional amendments. Both presidents were members of parliament and used parliament to amend the constitution in a manner that excluded participatory democracy. The people were not involved in any way. By 1992, and because of this, all key institutions, the judiciary, parliament, public services, security forces, and the provincial administration were instruments of authoritarian control. Concentration of power in the president was one of the factors that prompted demands for a new constitution, and the 2010 constitution aimed to curb dictatorship by parliament in the amendment process. Kenyans wanted to have a head of state who would not whimsically amend the constitution. They wanted to limit the powers of the constitutional amendment by the head of state, but not to take it away altogether. In other words, the intention was to make it difficult, but not impossible, for a president to make a constitutional amendment. This is the mischief that the framers of the constitution sought to address. In my considered view, therefore, there is no historical evidence that the drafters of the constitution intended that the president be excluded from the popular initiative amendment route, or that it be limited to a specific class of people to the exclusion of others. If anything, the resultant very expansive Chapter 4 on the Bill of Rights in the Constitution of Kenya 2010 proves otherwise. The president enjoys all constitutional rights and freedoms like any other Kenyan. He is first and foremost a Kenyan citizen by birth. A president does not lose his or her political rights under Article 38. He or she does not cease to be a registered voter by virtue of ascendancy to presidency. There is no law pursuant to Article 24 of the Constitution, which is the limitation clause, that limits the president from enjoying political rights under Article 38, especially that of campaigning for political cause, which in my view includes constitutional amendments. In addition, trusting citizens with public office does not in any way muzzle them or take away their rights, as provided in the Bill of Rights. Article 27(1) of the Constitution provides that every person is equal before the law and has the right to equal protection and equal benefit of the law. Additionally, equality includes the full and equal enjoyment of all rights and fundamental freedoms, and the President, like all Kenyans, is obligated to respect, uphold, and safeguard the Constitution. If any Kenyan has the right to initiate a popular amendment to the Constitution, while respecting, upholding, and defending the Constitution, so too does the President in his official or personal capacity. It would be restrictive, unjust, unprogressive, and unconstitutional to limit that right. At this juncture, I find it prudent to comment on the submissions that the President is excluded from promoting changes to the Constitution by popular initiative because he can do so through Parliament. According to Article 256 of the Constitution can only be amended through a parliamentary initiative. Under Article 256 of the Constitution is silent as to who can introduce a bill into either of the Houses of Parliament. However, the composition of Parliament is clear, and the membership of the National Assembly is provided for under Article 97(1), and that of Senate under Article 98(1). The President is excluded as a Member of Parliament. In other words, the President is not a Member of Parliament, and by parity of reason, he cannot introduce a constitutional amendment through a parliamentary initiative. Apart from making the finding that the President cannot initiate constitutional changes, the superior courts also found that state organs similarly cannot initiate such changes. However, it is important to note that all state organs and state officers form part of the national executive, county governments, the legislature, the judiciary, independent commissions, and independent offices. Accordingly, then, all holders of such offices under Article 1 also exercise delegated power from the people and must perform their functions in accordance with the Constitution. If those functions require measures or policy actions that would require constitutional changes, then they must be able to use their delegated authority to exercise those functions. To suggest otherwise would result in an absurdity. For example, let us assume the Chief Justice as the chair of the Judicial Service Commission wishes to make proposals on judicial reforms, and she puts together a draft bill and presents it to the IEBC as a promoter. If we were to follow the findings of the superior courts, the Chief Justice would find herself barred from proceeding. However, if her Chief of Staff or the Deputy Chief Registrar were to take the same document, it would be acceptable. Similarly, if the Speaker, as the Chair of the Parliamentary Service Commission, wished to make some proposals, constitutional proposals, around parliamentary reform, the judgment of the Superior Court would prevent him from taking such amendments himself, although the Clerk of the National Assembly and the Head of the Legal Department in Parliament can do so. The result is leadership without authority. In a democratic government, it is an untenable absurdity. In conclusion, I'd like to say on this point, the popular initiative amendment is not a preserve of specific persons. Any Kenyan can originate and promote the popular initiative amendment, and the people, as defined in the Constitution, also mean their representatives exercising donated sovereignty. As such, it remains an inclusive process and not a process that excludes and that empowers every person to propose constitutional amendments. Having found that the President and the state organs can promote a popular initiative, who then was the real promoter in the impugned bill in the dispute before us? A perusal of volume 34, page 226 of Marara Omoke's record of appeal, reveals the replying affidavit of Dennis Wawero, whereby he swears that he and Junet Mohammed are the co-chairpersons of the Building Bridges to a United Kenya, created and mandated with the task of initiating a constitutional amendment process and unifying Kenyans, among other things. From the record, IEBC's press release acknowledges the receipt of the Constitutional Amendment Bill 2020 and the 4.4 million supporter signatures. There is also a letter from IEBC which specifically talks of the promoters as Dennis Wawero and Junet Mohammed. It is therefore my conclusion that the promoters referred to in this bill are Dennis Wawero and Junet Mohammed. The record speaks for itself. Further, having perused the Constitution of Kenya Amendment Bill 2020 in Annexure B of the report of the Steering Committee of the Implementation of Building Bridges to a United Kenya Task Force report of October 2020 and the Constitution of Kenya Amendment Bill 2020, November 25, 2020, and the promoter's bill that was forwarded to county assemblies and parliament, I make observations that the bills are vastly different in terms of content and proposed amendments. For instance, while the Steering Committee Annexure Bill does not propose amendments to Articles 82, 89, 1, 96.3, 115.4, 168, 188.1, 204, 206, 207, 228, and 250 of the Constitution, the promoter's bill does. The bill as presented by the promoters to the IEBC does not contain some of the amendments contained in the Steering Committee Bill, namely amendments to Articles 91, 200, and the repeal and replacement of Article 218, insertion of 218A, amendments to Articles 221, 223, and the repeal and replacement of Articles 246. In addition, there are new Articles 108A, 153A, 206A, which only appear in the promoter's bill and do not appear in the committee steering bill. There are also major differences in the preambles, in the first and second schedule, which are substantially different. So they are two different documents. None of the superior courts examined this fact, leading them to the erroneous conclusion that the BBI steering committee, the BBI task force, and the promoters were one and the same. Neither Junet Mohammed or Dennis Wawere were part of the BBI steering committee or the BBI task force, both of which were gazetted by the president. They are similarly named initiative, of which their part has no legal nexus with the two gazetted entities. It is clear in correspondence between IEBC and the promoters that they engaged the IEBC as individuals and were not representing any entity, including the president. As I conclude on this issue, I fault the superior courts for making declarations of unconstitutionality without specifically itemizing the article of the Constitution that was either denied, violated, infringed, or threatened. For instance, the superior courts found the BBI process of initiating amendments to the Constitution unconstitutional. Which specific article of the Constitution it offended or threatened, it is still unclear. The superior courts ought to have dissected the issue to specific actions that were taken against the constitutional provisions against which they could be measured. Instead, it would appear that the focus was on actions, actors, and processes which are not within the constitutional ambit and, in particular, which are not to be found under Article 257 of the Constitution. In summary, my finding on the issue is the President did not initiate the amendment process in dispute. He was not the promoter of the popular initiative under 257. I now move to the third issue, which is whether the second schedule to the Constitution of Kenya bill is unconstitutional. Before ascertaining the unconstitutionality of the second schedule, it is important to interrogate the legal standing of the impugned bill. In Black's Law Dictionary, a bill is defined as a legislative proposal offered for debate before enactment. Article 109 of the Constitution says that Parliament shall exercise its legislative power through bills passed by Parliament and assented by the President. In addition, Article 1 of the Constitution talks about the coming into force of laws and speaks of the bill passed by Parliament, assented by the President, shall be published in the Kenya Gazette as an Act of Parliament within 7 days after assent. Accordingly, a bill does not become law until it is passed by the legislature, and the President completes the legislative process by formally assenting or giving his consent to the bill. Articles 2.4 and 165 of the Constitution contemplate scenarios where laws are unconstitutional and can be declared so. The Constitution does not provide for pre-enactment mechanisms to determine whether a bill is constitutional or not. So in this instant matter, the judges of the Court of Appeal did declare the second schedule of the Constitution unconstitutional, but considering that the Constitution Amendment Bill had not yet been promulgated into law, I find fault with the Superior Court's finding on the basis that they did not have jurisdiction to interrogate the constitutionality of a bill before it's been passed into law. I reiterate, it's only after a bill has been enacted and attained the status of a law that the courts acquire jurisdiction to entertain the same. But before a bill is enacted into law or an act of parliament, the courts don't have jurisdiction to determine the same for lack of ripeness. Now, having found that there's the issue of lack of ripeness, what can this court do? Can it proceed to address the same? And if so, under what circumstances? In the case of Aramat, this court did state that this court's jurisdiction is to develop rich jurisprudence that develops and respects Kenya's history and traditions and facilitates its social and economic growth, and that the Supreme Court is the guardian of the Constitution and the final arbiter. And the same principle was carried, was stated in the matter of Speaker of Senate and several other cases of this court. In light, and I've laid out the decisions, in light of all those decisions above, it is my considered view that the issue before us is one that cannot be ignored. However, there needs to be a test to assess whether indeed, despite the lack of ripeness, whether this court can actually address the issue. So this court needs to evaluate the fitness of the issue for judicial determination, and secondly, assess the hardship to the parties and the general public if judicial relief would be denied at this stage. In other words, is this the kind of question that can be determined only when ripe without occasioning any hardship to the parties or general public? I've then laid out a number of cases and writings around the fitness test on issues of ripeness and how one can assess whether an issue is fit despite the issue of ripeness. I do find, having laid out the issues around the test, I do find that in this particular situation that this court can apply the test and we can address the issues despite the lack despite the lack of ripeness surrounding the bill. Thus, I have perused the second schedule to the Constitution of Kenya Amendment Bill and noted that it seeks to introduce an amendment to Article 89.1. However, the schedule that is attached then purports to amend Articles 81, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6, but it purports to do this on its own without an accompanying proposed amendment to that section. In the UK Court of Appeal decision, Mohan versus Her Majesty's Senior Coroner for Oxfordshire, Lady Arden observed the follows. It would be contrary to drafting conventions for a schedule to be used to make what should clearly be what has a change or have, what will have some change or of consequence in the law. It is improper for a schedule to have matters of principle, and nothing should be placed in a schedule to which the attention of Parliament should be particularly directed. Flowing from the above, I am persuaded that the second schedule to the Constitution Amendment Bill, even if it were to be enacted into law, cannot amend Article 89 of the Constitution. It would be contrary to drafting conventions if the schedule of the Constitution was to propose an amendment to a substantive article of the Constitution on its own. What ought to have happened is that there needed to have been a standalone provision that brought the substantive amendments to Articles 89, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and 8. Therefore, the second schedule to the Constitutional Amendment Bill conflicts with the substantive provisions of Article 89 of the Constitution, and it is therefore unconstitutional. On issue number 4, on whether the President can be sued for performing functions of his office, I will be brief. The rationale for presidential immunity comes from the enormous responsibility bestowed upon a president as a single source of executive power. Therefore, immunity from legal proceedings is designed to permit a president to just discharge his obligations with as much autonomy as possible without anxiety that court proceedings would probably disturb, humiliate, or encumber him from focusing on his duties. This protection is also envisioned to shield the dignity of the office of the president and not him personally, particularly because he makes far-reaching and sensitive decisions. I have considered the party's pleadings and submissions, and it's obvious that the point of diversions is whether or not the president is immune from constitutional violations during his tenure of office. It is not contested that the president appointed the Building Bridges, the BBI task force, to document and recommend practical administrative reform processes that will build the country's long-lasting unity and implement modalities for each identified area. The president has a unique position in the constitutional scheme, and as already discussed in issue number 2, he has a responsibility to promote and enhance the unity of the nation. It is my finding, therefore, that if the president, it is my finding that the president, in appointing the BBI task force, was discharging his constitutional mandate, promoting and enhancing the unity of Kenya, and consequently, there was no basis for concluding that the president's actions contravene the constitution to deprive him of immunity provided for under Article 143. Of the Constitution. There's no evidence tabled before the trial court to dispute this, and that his actions were not within the four corners of his constitutional mandate of promoting and uniting the country. One may ask what recourse is available to a party who is aggrieved by the presidential actions or omissions that grossly violates the Constitution and is outside his constitutional function. And Article 145 provides any member of the National Assembly, supported with at least one-third of members, the ability to move a motion of impeachment. And that is how to deal with it. To this end, I do disagree with Tuyot Justice Tuyot on his conclusion that Article 132 leaves it open for the President to be held personally liable once out of office for any act or omission not done in office. And my finding is that the President's actions or omissions entitle him to immunity as provided for in under 143 of the Constitution. I'll move quickly to the next issue, which is public participation. And this is what I'll say. To determine whether the Constitution Amendment Bill 2020 was subjected to public participation within the parameters of Article 257 of the Constitution, we need to examine the steps and inbuilt mechanisms that are provided for therein. In my opinion, the steps are as follows: the submission of the bill and the minimum 1 million signature of registered voters. Then the verification of signatures by IEBC. Then the consideration of county assemblies. Then the consideration of the House of Parliament, and then the referendum. So when we go to the first step, Mr. Omoke urged us that the promoters ought to have conducted public participation prior to the collection of signatures. But on this, it is my finding that the collection of signatures is not a constitutional process under Chapter 16 of the under Chapter 16, and the promoters are not under any obligation to conduct public participation prior to the collection of signatures. In order to assess whether the public participation has been conducted in accordance with the specific provision of the Constitution, the test which a court ought to apply is against a particular provision. So to my mind, Article 257 of the Constitution does not first provide for the collection of signatures, but for the submission of a bill with at least 1 million signatures. This, in my opinion, is the first step. And then second, it does not make provision for public participation during the collection of signatures. Having found that Article 257 does not expressly provide for public participation during the collection of signatures, the standard to apply when assessing the same, if any, will be lower than the law, than where the law is expressly provided for public participation. I am unable to agree with the Court of Appeal's findings that there was a constitutional requirement to conduct public civic education at the point of collection of signatures. And I cannot concur with Nambuye's finding that there was need to give the public the reports, the bill in Kiswahili, Braille, sign language before the referendum. Having found that the constitutional amendment process commences with the submission of signatures and that the constitution is silent on pre-bill procedures, it is my considered opinion that the promoters were not required to take public participation at this juncture. From the foregoing, it is my presumption that when a supporter signs in support of the draft bill, then such a supporter must have read, understood, and agreed to the proposed as amendments, asked questions about any unclear proposal, and taken the decision to be bound by his or her signature. It therefore goes without saying that the promoter, before urging his, the support, a support of his or her proposal, must talk to people or must have made his bill understood by the people. I disagree that there was no, I disagree with the court's conclusion that there was no public participation during the collection of signatures. And moving on to the next step is to consider whether there was public participation at the county assemblies. I take judicial notice that in compliance with the Constitution and the County Governments Act, county assemblies have standing orders with set guidelines on public participation, and in that regard, a bill in the county assembly, having been read for the first time, is committed to the relevant selector committee, where it takes into account views and recommendations from the public and reports back to the county assembly. I've looked at the record, and it's my conclusion that none of the petitioners before the High Court specifically alleged that any of the county assemblies failed to conduct a public participation as per the standing orders. Similarly, there is a similar process before the two houses of parliament, and there is no evidence that this public participation did not take place. It is my finding, therefore, that there was public participation at the county level and at the houses of Parliament. The final step in assessing public participation under Article 257 is at the referendum stage, but we had not reached there. Lastly, on this question of public participation, I believe it is time for the legislature to urgently provide for the parameters of public participation. I recommend it does so through a statutory enabling framework. Such legislation should provide precision and clarity on the various processes involved and address issues like mode, extent, stages, proof of public participation, funding, responsibilities of who does what and when. Does the IBC have the requisite quorum to conduct business? It is my finding that it does. And I'm sorry. And I have then come to the two conflicting decisions in the High Court, which were raised by parties. It is my considered view that even though horizontal stare decisis is not binding on courts of equal jurisdiction, the trial courts need to follow the decision of other judges of the same court unless there are compelling reasons to depart from the same. This is to ensure consistency, certainty, predictability, and sound judicial administration. In this context, having found that paragraph 5 of the second schedule of IBC Act is constitutional, it is my finding that it was justified for the trial court in the Isaiah Biwott case to depart from the Katiba case. Furthermore, in this present case, I'm not persuaded that there existed compelling reasons to warrant the trial court in this case to depart from the Isaiah Biwott case. I have then laid out my reasoning around retrospective unconstitutionality and prospective unconstitutionality, and I think that I will leave that for parties to read when they read my full judgment. Finally, on the last issue, I do agree that the issue is not ripe, like the Chief Justice has stated. However, once again, the fitness and hardship test, which I developed when I was writing issue number 2, I think does apply. And I have made findings that there can only be one question at referendum and that the provisions of Section 49 are unconstitutional. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, the Honorable Justice Njoki Ndung'u, for rendering your opinion.